Bienvenidos otra vez. Orangoan hasiko ga, lehen esan dugun bezala, goizan zar entzungo ditugun kasuekin. Espezializazioa adimendunan hainbat kasu ikusiko ditugu herrialde ezberdinetatik etorri dian hizlarien partetik. Eta lehenengoa Luc Hamecker izango da, Holandakoa. Luc Hamecker will be the first speaker this morning. And he's the program manager of Brainport 2020 strategy from 2011, which has developed into the Brainport network now. He's secretary of the executive board and the managing board and responsible for the projects, communication, and monitoring of the program. In this function, he communicates frequently with the regional and national governments, as well as with Brussels. So Luc, whenever you're ready, the stage is yours.
Yes. Thank you very much. I'm going to start my presentation. I'm very happy that you're having me here and being in this beautiful town, San Sebastian, in the region of Basque country. So I want to tell you more about Brainport Network. We got a nice saying about it's top economy, but also it's smart society. Well, where is it located? Yeah, you know Holland, I hope. It's very up north, and we have three economic hotspots in Holland. And we call them airports, Amsterdam, Schiphol, the airport, a lot of economic focus on ICT also. We got the seaport, Rotterdam, with one of the biggest harbors of the world, with all the logistics coming in from the ships from China and transporting it through Holland to Germany, Belgium, to the rest of Europe. And then we got Brainport. So that's the way we think about it. You got airport, seaport, and Brainport. And Brainport is because of the technical university. It's because of the high-tech focus here with a lot of research and development investments I'm going to talk to you about later. And it's not only Brainport, it's a combination of focus in Brainport Eindhoven. There is located the main big high-tech companies like Philips and ASML I'm going to tell you about. It's also about the multi-level cooperation with six regions. So we've got two regions, Agri-Food Capital and Greenport Venlo, which is focused on Agri-Food. We got in the south, Limburg Economic Development, that's focused on chemistry. It was first a region of coal mining, so it went all... the coal mining stopped 30 years ago and they redeveloped it into a chemistry campus, the Camelot campus. Sounds like the castle, the Camelot castle of King Arthur, but it's only a lot of smoke and a lot of chemistry going on there. I've got Keyport region and Midpoint Brabant that's focused in Tilburg, it's also University of Social Innovation. But you see, and also we got... We were located in two provinces, the province of Noord-Brabant and the province of Limburg. And together we form the Brainport Network, eight partners working together on three teams and three subjects, which I'm going to tell you about it. It's very important to know we all believe in triple helix cooperation. You only become a member of Brainport Network if you work triple helix. So working together with the government, the local government, working together with the university, with the knowledge institutions, and working together with the companies, the enterprises. And we believe that you have to have some of the go in the south of Holland. You lived in the last of the years in the south of France, making all the beautiful sunflowers, pictures, and this was at the late of the 19th century in our region. It was a bit grim. It's called the potato eaters. And it was, south of Holland was a very poor country, poor agriculture, not much industry, not much and big families. And it was also the soil, the basic of Philips to grow, because they also started in the late 19th century about making light bulbs. That was the origin of Philips. And they need a lot of factory workers to make them. It was all made by hand. So they had a huge community of labor force in Eindhoven and surroundings had to get to work into factories. Philips was a very strong company. which also invest in housing for the people, in education. They got special funds for the kids of the labor force to get their education, and also sport. Of course, PSV Eindhoven had a sense that stands for Philips Sports Club. So that's really strong. And also another company, DAF, who makes the trucks. Also a big company, very dominating in Eindhoven. But then 100 years later, in the 1990s, major crisis. That's one of the former CEOs of Philips to the left. He's really troubled because Philips has gone. A lot of competition going on from Asia, from other countries. Philips has grown to a very huge company, making everything from glass to DVDs, cassettes. There were all components they made by themselves. It was getting a very huge conglomerate with a lot of also bureaucracy, but they had a lot of trouble with the competition coming. So they had to reorganize and made a lot of people redundant. And the same happened to DAF, it went broke. It's not unbelievable, a truck company went broke. So that was a major crisis, and well, we always say in Brainport, you need a crisis to get the real collaboration together. So then it was very interesting. The mayor of Eindhoven then said, we can't let this happen. We can't lose and let 10,000 people lose their jobs. That's not going to happen. So I want a meeting together with the university, together with Philips, together with DAF. How are we going to solve this? So then started Brainport, the Triple Helix Corporation, with a stimulus program that was really fixing all the problems, starting with projects, how can we innovate, and then we get the next programs, Horizon. It's not the Horizon program of European Union now, but it was in 2002. Horizon, how can we innovate together? And then the next programs, Brainport 2013, Brainport 2020. That was also important because then the mayor of Eindhoven said, well, all the focus is going always to seaport and airport, always going to Amsterdam and Rotterdam. I want the focus here. We make the most of the money here in the south of the Holland with the big companies. We invest a lot in research and development. Economic growth is coming here to Eindhoven, and the Minister of Economic Affairs said, okay, but then you have to develop a program for the southeast of Netherlands with the six regions. And now we are in the next generation, Brainport, I'm going to tell you about. Well, it's very important to see that the main companies, we call them the original equipment manufacturing companies, who have the big companies like DAF, Philips, ASML. I don't know if you know ASML, but a lot of companies like FAY, they make electronic microscopes. ASML, they make the machines to make the wafers to make chips. So that's at this moment, ASML, spin-off of Philips, is bigger than Philips in Holland now. They're working 12,000 people at this moment. And also, Philips is important. They're getting smaller and smaller because they are now focusing totally on healthcare. They just recently sold their Philips lighting department, and they focus now only on healthcare. But the important is to see the focus on the first picture, the main companies, and then it's all about the suppliers, the SMEs. That's where the growth is, and we believe in the cooperation with all the SMEs, because then it's always very important. Then the main companies, they don't go. They're really dependent. ASML is dependent of 80 suppliers, and they are united in that one and Brainport Industries. So 80 industries are combined, talking with ASML how to innovate together to the next programs. So get those suppliers aligned and work together in the region to develop. And that's the main figures about the research and development. So ASML is spending a lot of money. It's about 800 million euros this in 2016. Philips still investing a lot. NXP making a lot of components. DAF. VDL is a manufacturing company which now makes buses, but also has a manufacturing company in the south of Limburg, and the point there, which is making now the minis for BMW. So it's really growing fast. But also we have to take account, I don't know, it's really St. Peter Square, but we have, it's the same location. 2005, there were the smartphones. Now, in 2013, everything's changing. It's changing rapidly. So Paul was talking about it, the changes are so fast nowadays. Can we still have those big programs we have been running now? So in Brainport, we believe very much in what Charles Darwin said. The most important is to be adaptable, to be adaptive, to be flexible. And, well, that's where we're focusing now. It's very, very innovative. How can we manage this to be adaptive? Well, this is not new for you. This is also much of what Europe tells us. Believe in the societal changes that create new businesses. Which are there? The health, safety, I mentioned here also, energy, agri-food, and mobility. So I was talking to Christoph, who's been at the conference in Eindhoven, and he engaged in a project of us. We got a road from Helmond to Eindhoven, which is all about connecting cars. So we believe that in the future, you can adapt cars to go like a train on the road. So they're all connected together. They need less space, and they can solve the mobility problems. And of course, about health, now Brainport is focusing on Brainport Health, Healthy Living Labs. How can we focus with Philips on preventing diseases? Because all the people are getting much older, but how can we invest to prevent that people are getting sick? So that's huge programs with a lot of focus. How can we create new business on these societal challenges? Well, this is a difficult one. I always have to figure out how to, but that is the development of the fertile soil. So outside of Holland, it's all sand. We could all only got sand to collaborate on, the agri-food soil we have. But it's also the soil of collaboration. And the foundation of everything is the collaboration. And then we see the new techniques. It's not all about techniques. It's also, of course, about social innovation. How can we implement new techniques by working together and to look at what the people in the population really need and the people who have to work with the technique. But the focus here on South Holland is very much on high-tech systems. Data science, of course, is a very important development. And we believe in a wet one. And a real new technique is coming on from the Technical University of Eindhoven. We believe that photonics is the next big change. So all the data centers are working with the microchips and all connected with each other, and they're consuming a lot of energy, and photonics is going to be the next move, that all the communication goes by light, by communicating by the light systems. So we have to be in front of those new technologies with our partners, universities and the companies, to stimulate the new way to go. How do we do it? Because I'm from a regional development company, and we're not in charge of the companies. The companies do their thing, and they work international, they work in Europe, they work together, universities work together. But when you focus on the industries, well, what can you supply by the growing sectors in your region? You can do, we believe, from a regional development company, five things. I focus on three of them. You focus on people. You have to have the right talents to develop and innovate, but you also have the working force to do all the things that has to be done. If you haven't got the talents, you really got a problem. You focus on the basics. You have to have a real good infrastructure with the roads, the railways, good environment to live in, a green environment. So the people and expats coming into Holland, they like to live in Holland, so that's the basics, very important. The business, next subjects, how can we can invent, but it's also going to be business. We got to earn money, so how can we create that, the business, and how can we arrange funds for business to grow. Technology is a bit more about the right research and development. And international is a bit where we are here today. How can we work together with other regions to develop new technology, but also innovation? That are focus areas in which we invest a lot from our regional development company. And I'm going to focus from the BrainPort Network on three items: people. So employment. Now at ASML, we got about 150 job vacancies a month, and it just introduced a new technique which requires a lot of process engineers. They can't find them, so they're looking abroad. They're looking at all other countries, from South Korea to Taiwan to Ottawa in Canada, to Boston, America, from Asia, to fly in the expats to come to Holland to work at ASML. There's also a focus still in Holland. We got a mismatch of demand and supply in the labor market. So still, we got now 5-6% unemployment. But 5%, well, they don't match with what now the industry is needing, what the companies are needing. So that we want to solve. And one of the projects is focused on upgrading competences. How can you educate people more to fix with the required competence or skills? OECD had a very nice report on the skills of the future. Now our universities say, we don't know how to train the students for what jobs. We don't know the jobs of the future. Everything, you go back to where all the jobs are changing now, and that's why you have to be adaptive. You can train to be a carpenter or something like that, but you have to train the skills to perform jobs for the rest of your life. And so we believe also in permanent education or long life learning. How can we invest that with the national and regional government to have a permanent education of the labor force itself? We're also very proud of innovative labor market dashboards. How can we really focus on the supply and demand in the region? So that combining all the data, and then you can see what's really needed in the market, the labor market, and how to educate people to those jobs and competences. Cross-border collaboration, all about today, yeah, six regions. We are directly with a border with Belgium and Germany, so that makes us very unique, two borders. So we work a lot together with these countries. We've got a worldwide international talent program. And I want to mention, of course, one of the programs here with the Basque Country. For every year, 30 trainees from your region work in the BrainPort region for half a year. And they get a lot of experience, and some of them stay, and a lot of them go back to your country. It's not a brain drain. It's not always, oh, it's a brain drain. No, we call it a brain gain, or circulation of brains. So let's educate together. I think that's very important. Well, Capital is a specific team. You've got a lot of startups in the ecosystem focused on those clusters of high-tech and agri-food and chemistry. And they want to start. They want to have to start up. Well, we facilitate that in the ecosystem. We also very focused on the scale-ups, because that's where it's happening. And there's the real growth going on. When you have a new technique developed, then you scale up, and then you miss the funds. There's hardly no money to find to really invest, and certainly in the high-tech sector, where it involves really big investments. So we're working together with the Dutch National and Regional Banks to discuss how can we find money from you, but also from the participation companies and the private investors. And now the last dot is about creating a big scale-up fund with the provinces. The provinces in Holland, some of them are very rich because they used to own the energy companies. They sold it and they got millions of money from selling those, so they got a lot of money to invest in innovation. So we're trying to build up with the province of Brabant and the European banks for big scale-up funds for really high-tech new companies. And it's really needed because some of the guys had a conference lately and they were saying, well, I can't grow anymore. I need now a lot of money to invest in a new technique, or I'm stopping, or I'm waiting to some Chinese company to buy me. And that's not what we are hoping that will happen. So there's capital theme, and of course, international AU. We really believe had to work together with different regions from our strengths, the clusters we got. And we're seeking international collaboration and project programs with Germany and Belgium, of course, but also with some projects. Also, Emilia-Romagna is involved and other regions, 30 regions, the Vanguard Initiative to put the making industry back on its place. We call it the renaissance of the making industry. We have very focused in advanced manufacturing, 3D printing, to work together with those other regions. We've got InfoShare, sharing strategies with different regions, also immediately around Romania and Flanders, Belgium, and a growth program with another 10 regions, with only some examples how we collaborate with the rest of Europe, which I think is very important. Of course, we've got big conferences, and one times a year we've got six regions with six boards, and we've got two provinces. So every year we've got a big castle meeting with all our boards of members, the mayors of the cities, the king's commissioner and the regional minister, the Ministry of Affairs, of Economic Affairs, but also with the boards of the six regions. Every year we have a castle meeting, once in Limburg, once in Brabant. We've got a lot of castles, so we can go very long. It's good to have like this meeting to come together and discuss the program and the new things we're going to do. So last year we hosted two conferences. We believe very much in meeting up with the other regions. This in May, June, it was a big WIRE conference in Eindhoven, the Week of Innovative Regions. And in November, it was the TCI, the meeting up with all the cluster organizations. That's a global conference in South Korea. It was in, I believe it was also here, Robin. Yeah, so that's really a big meetup. How can we stimulate for clustering of companies and knowledge institution? That's a very important issue for the future. Well, I don't know, it's up to Paolo, but I made some questions. Perhaps we can find some answers, but we can always try. So I got some questions because I heard here the politicians say, well, there's unemployment here still, but we're facing the next problem. We believe that the next crisis is going to be the crisis on the labor market. We don't have the people to do all the work, and that's a real problem at this moment. The scale-up funds, well, I was talking about some companies who are thinking of quitting or leaving our region because they can't get fast enough money to grow. And then just link with the TCI conference, clusters are very hot. How can you combine clusters? And there's a lot of discussion who's in the lead of making clusters. Is that the regional government or the companies itself, or universities? But the regions, do they have a part in making clusters trans-Europe? Well, a thing I like to discuss. Okay, well, ask the technique, because we're doing some kind of competence of videos. If we can summarize my speech, if I was telling the truth, so from YouTube, we're going to try to summarize what I just told you. Let's see if it made any sense. It's working.
Six triple helix regions in southeast Netherlands and the provinces of Noord-Brabant and Limburg are united in Brainport Network, a unique network of business and industry, government and knowledge institutions, all with a common aim: to develop southeast Netherlands into the leading European open innovation and top technology region, a powerful provider of the solutions the world needs now. Action is a priority for three areas: an innovative approach to employment, better accessibility to capital for innovative companies, and more pan-European collaboration. In Southeast Netherlands, demand for technical talent still outweighs the supply. European research shows that if you can remove the mismatch between demand and supply, you can cut unemployment by 3.5%. The eight partners have taken a step in the right direction by co-developing the Employment Dashboard. Access to capital for innovative companies that want to grow is crucial for economic growth and employment. Brainport's network wants to bring demand and supply closer together and thereby close the capital chain. There are still too few top sector players in Southeast Netherlands that engage in European projects. Brainport Network clusters knowledge and expertise from powerful clusters, also crossover in Southeast Netherlands. The Vanguard Initiative, a strategic initiative of 28 European regions, is using large-scale demonstration projects geared to future-focused industrial niche markets that are ripe for a market breakthrough. The initiatives referred to help Brainport Network to fulfill its aim: to make Southeast Netherlands Europe's leading open innovation region.
My presentation, don't know if there are... telling the truth. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your presentation. El siguiente caso es el caso de Finlandia. Tenemos a Jerker Johnson aquí desde la región de Ostrobotnia y nos va a presentar lo que hacen allí. Mr. Johnson is here with us. He's an economist with a specialization in development economics. He is currently coordinating the international activities and partnerships of the Regional Council and leads the smart specialization development work in the region of Ostrobotnia. He has a first-hand experience of EU policy, instruments ranging from FP7 to territorial cooperation and local development. Johnson has a multi-country experience working as a long and short-term advisor on building statistical systems for national accounting in different countries, such as South America, Asia, Middle East, and Africa. In addition to this, he has worked as an academic researcher and teacher in economics and statistics on the university level. So here with us, when you're ready, thank you.
Buenos días. Yo creo que voy a aprovechar la oportunidad de practicar mi castellano. Primero, gracias por invitarme. Hemos trabajado mucho con el País Vasco. Primero fue el proyecto del RESCEN, que fue un proyecto del séptimo marco, regiones de conocimiento. Luego hemos trabajado con una serie de proyectos de Reina, de cooperación de clústeres, tratando de buscar mercados por nuestros productos en los mercados fuera de Europa, en África y también en América Latina. Eso ha sido una cooperación muy fructífera para nosotros, hemos aprovechado mucho. Y por eso me alegro de tener la oportunidad de también presentar unas ideas nuestras. Yo vengo de Ostrobotnia, que es una región en la costa occidental de Finlandia, 450 kilómetros noreste de Helsinki. Al otro lado es Umeå, en Suecia. Somos una región bilingual. Hablamos, la mayoría hablan sueco, 50% más o menos, finlandés 45% y otros idiomas más o menos 5%. La mayor ciudad es Vasa. Y cambiamos aquí con el escaudio y español, cambiamos tiempo, todo el tiempo. El idioma es que hablamos quizás en el trabajo cotidiano, que 5 minutos finlandés y 5 minutos suecos y así. Bueno, es la realidad. Bueno, yo voy a dividir mi presentación en hablar en visión, análisis, gobernanza, prioridades, combinación de política y monitoreo usando la estructura sugerida por la plataforma. Aquí es algo sobre nuestra economía. tenemos un clúster de energía que es muy fuerte, como el País Vasco, que exportan a todos los lugares del mundo, y eso es algo, por supuesto, algo muy afortunado para nosotros, porque somos la región que ha crecido más rápido desde el turno del milenio en Finlandia. Y claro, por la razón que producimos tecnologías y productos de energía renovable, y ahora tenemos una demanda mundial muy grande por la amenaza del cambio climático y también por razones del Acuerdo de París y las políticas de muchas regiones. Y eso es algo, por supuesto, muy bueno, porque es como pan y mantequilla para nosotros, pero también es un mundo muy competitivo. Las compañías líderes son multinacionales y pueden estar en otro lugar del mundo mañana, porque la competición internacional es muy dura. Tenemos también otras estructuras de pymes que funcionan en la cadena de producción con esas compañías y que son bastante dependientes. Hablamos de un lock-in, es decir, que pymes que con compañías con 1 a 5 personas que producen por las compañías que están enfrentados todo el tiempo de mejorar su calidad y reducir los costos. Y tienen dificultades, hablamos de un lock-in o un bloqueo económico en este sentido, porque claro que como son compañías internacionales, pueden también tomar sus productos de otra parte del mundo, de China o de otros lugares. Y por eso vivimos en un mundo muy, muy competitivo. Aquí es el nombre de una de esas compañías líderes. Entonces se puede decir que nuestro sistema de innovación es impulsado por los negocios. Y eso es algo bueno. ¿Cómo pasan las innovaciones? Es muchas veces que tenemos asociaciones de compañías trabajando con el triple hélice, no todo el tiempo, pero en la mayoría de los casos, trabajando con las compañías y buscando nuevas soluciones. Y por eso hablamos sobre un doing, using, interacting, DUI por sus sigla en inglés, que es una innovación basada en la práctica y basada en la experiencia. Eso es algo muy fuerte. Claro que ellos están también trabajando con las universidades, pero muchas de las universidades son en todos los lugares del mundo, no tanto en la universidad. Tenemos también una universidad de Vasa y aunque no varias universidades, pero ellos no son tan fuerte que pueden trabajar con las compañías todo el tiempo. Bueno, entonces nuestro punto de partir era que preguntar qué hace, si hablamos de un sistema de innovación, era que preguntar qué hace que sea un sistema. Y la respuesta que hemos dado es un diálogo estructurado sobre la innovación. Entonces el enfoque a la experiencia del cliente es tener un diálogo sobre su mundo, cómo podemos aprovechar las cadenas globales que tienen las compañías líderes para una innovación de variación relacionada. Y eso es un diálogo, cómo podemos aprovechar su experiencia, cómo podemos ampliar el base de exportación y de innovación, porque es un hecho aceptado que las compañías que trabajan en un entorno global son más innovadoras que los que trabajan por el mercado doméstico. Entonces, cómo podemos transferir el conocimiento, la práctica, el conocimiento tácito que tienen ellos a las compañías en la red bastante, bastante dependiente? Bueno, aquí es una situación, una visión que tenemos. Bueno, tenemos una visión de ser una región conectada, adaptado el formato de plataforma de Lewis Kempton, y es claro, es un reto continuo. Si algo pasa, quizás las redes de innovaciones no están funcionando tan bien. Bueno, claro que tenemos un multitud de actores con diferentes perspectivas en nuestra región. Si hablamos de gente, tenemos una representación del Estado aquí en nuestra región, tenemos gente de regiones, tenemos gente de municipios y tenemos gente de todos los países, de universidades, de sector público y de las empresas. Y eso usan las mismas palabras, pero refiere a otro contexto. Y eso muchas veces es un problema en tener un diálogo, porque usamos las mismas palabras, pero pensamos en diferentes cosas. Y entonces se tiene que elaborar un modelo para explicar a todos esto es la manera que pensamos sobre la expresión inteligente. ¿Qué más? La expresión inteligente es una política basada en el lugar. Y claro que el sistema de innovación es diferente en Ostrobotnia, y entonces tenemos que, en alguna manera, hacer algo que corresponde a nuestra realidad. Es también una caja de herramientas, y eso tiene la ventaja que podemos comunicar con otras regiones, usar también su experiencia y soluciones que han adaptadas a la política, en la política de expresión inteligente. Hemos trabajado con el País Vasco, estamos trabajando con Chile, pero también el mayor trabajo hacemos es con países alrededor del Mar Báltico, en nuestra cercanía. Algo sobre eso es mucho el reto que estamos enfrentando es que tenemos en un sector público que no existe una coherencia en la política, y tenemos un sector privado que está motivado por sus propios intereses, y quizás también un sector de educación superior que quizás está en la región, pero no está trabajando con los desafíos de la región. Y por eso el reto es tratar de juntarnos, no perfectamente, pero tratar de también tener la perspectiva de la región. Claro que es muy bueno que educamos a gente para el mundo, para las redes internacionales, pero tenemos también que no solamente ser integrados verticalmente, sino también horizontalmente. Y eso es algo muy importante, trabajar con esto y fomentar esto con la política. La visión es lo opuesto, es ser un región conectado. Significa que, claro que las universidades de Vasa no pueden satisfacer todas las necesidades de las compañías, pero es una ventaja si, por ejemplo, tenemos Hanken, que es una escuela de negocios, trabajando con Wärtsilä, que es una compañía multinacional. Ellos no pueden solucionar sus problemas porque son una escuela de negocios, pero pueden producir unas tesis de másteres a ellos y pueden cooperar entre ellos. Y es muy importante, consideramos que alguien en Wärtsilä conoce qué podemos esperar de Hanken y viceversa, y que no podemos esperar de Hanken. Y que Hanken puede, en su enseñanza, por ejemplo, de economistas, tomar ejemplo del mundo Wärtsilä. Y eso es lo que hablamos de la región conectada, es que se entiende el mundo del otro hélice. Claro que es si cómo construir una sesión sostenible, tener una visión de lugar compartido, pero también edificar canales muy fuertes de comunicación dentro de la sesión y el mundo externo. Claro que tenemos un diálogo estructurado que hacemos con las compañías, con las universidades, con los stakeholders. Es un diálogo cerrado porque unas cosas son un poquito sensibles, pero también comunicamos los resultados abiertamente. Y eso es muy, y entonces el diálogo puede funcionar como un benchmark, que eso es que opina el gobierno regional. Y entonces puede afectar el pensamiento y fuera también de la asociación. El análisis es, por supuesto, orientación hacia el exterior, porque las compañías producen la mayor parte del valor agregado. Y hablamos de un modelo, de sistema de producción de gansos voladores, que es algo que han inventado los japoneses hace mucho tiempo, indicando que un beneficio mutuo de la exportación y que tenemos en realidad una producción global en el mundo en que funcionamos. Claro que el pájaro primero es lo más innovativo y el pájaro último es lo mejor pagado, o lo peor pagado. Y entonces es una cuestión cómo queremos que posicionarnos. Si hablamos de la cadena de valor, podemos tomar un ejemplo, digamos tomates. Un litro de ketchup requiere 2 kilos de tomates, pero ¿cómo avanzar de ser productores de tomates a ser productores de ketchup? Y eso es cómo avanzar en la técnica. ¿Y qué requiere este avanzamiento del sistema de innovación? No solamente hacer una botella de ketchup, sino hacer la ketchup mejor del mundo para poder competir con el resto. Y aquí tenemos una exportadores, tenemos como 4 picos. El Saga Forces tenemos en nuestra región, es un granjas de pieles, tenemos una producción de pieles de de zorro y visón, visón sí. Visón también es para gente con demasiado dinero. Pero porque a veces son de muy buena calidad, porque a veces es un poquito frío en nuestro país, en Finlandia. Y también Wärtsilä, que es unas soluciones energéticas y tecnología de maritima y servicios. 50% de su producción hoy día es servicios. En los motores para los barcos tenemos 4 compañías mundialmente que son grandes, son el MAN, Caterpillar, Wärtsilä y Rolls-Royce. Y entonces es el entorno en que trabajan ellos. ABB, por supuesto, es un multinacional de tecnología energética. Y también Baltic Yacht, botes de lujo para, de nuevo, para gente con demasiado dinero. Pero eso es como ganamos la vida de nuestra Botnia. Después de esto tenemos los KETs, cuáles son las tecnologías claves, Key-Enabling Technologies en inglés, y después de esto tenemos áreas de investigación. Y claro que en Finlandia un sistema regional de innovación no es nada nuevo, sino hemos, por ejemplo, tenido un sistema universitario descentralizado desde las 60. Y entonces, pero en esta manera que pensar en qué es importante para las compañías, qué deberemos hacer y cómo. Y entonces la manera es buscar las brechas en este sistema, qué funciona o qué no funciona. Y eso es como la idea para la política de qué tipo de investigación necesitamos, cuáles son los stakeholders. Y si hablamos de la tecnología, cuáles son las importantes tecnologías para el futuro, cuáles son las áreas de investigación que es importante para esas compañías y dónde existen. Hablamos del sistema del sistema de innovación de Ostrobotnia, pero la realidad es que las compañías están en Ostrobotnia, pero el sistema es parcialmente en Ostrobotnia, pero es también un sistema mundial, es una idea de difusión internacional. Y por eso esto es la mera el mundo en que tenemos que funcionar. Lo que hacemos es un diálogo, preguntamos sobre las expectativas y experiencias de los socios del triple hélice. Entre el triple hélice hay como nuevas relaciones, que compañía, sector público, y entre ellos es 3x3. Entonces estamos mapeando todas las regiones de las socios de triple hélice y preguntamos sobre la experiencia y expectativa. Una brecha es la experiencia menos la expectativa menos la experiencia en una escala de 1 de 10. Y si tenemos una brecha más de 2, eso indica un problema. Y buscamos una política que tiene grandes expectativas y grandes experiencias. Y eso es también la manera de compararnos con diferentes regiones del Mar Báltico. ¿Qué hace Noruega mejor que nosotros? ¿Qué hace Lituania mejor que nosotros? Alemania, etcétera, etcétera. Para el aprendizaje político. Y luego de la diálogo estamos primero una encuesta donde preguntamos cuáles son las expectativas y experiencias, pero también sobre la tecnología ahora en el futuro. Y cuantificamos y analizamos, y luego tenemos grupos de enfoques sobre los resultados, es decir, que procedimiento de grupos focales, como hacer la política. ¿Qué es la razón, por ejemplo, que tú tienes una expectativa de tu socio de la universidad nuevo, por ejemplo, y la experiencia es 6? Entonces tenemos una brecha de 3. ¿Y qué es la razón por esta brecha? ¿Qué podemos hacer? Y luego hacemos un análisis de lógico, de marco lógico, en tratar de buscar soluciones. Aquí son unos resultados obtenidos como dije, que tenemos un sistema impulsado por las universidades y tenemos poca inversión pública en investigación y desarrollo en comparación con las empresas, por supuesto. Entonces, eso es un posible amenaza. También tenemos muy poca diversificación entre las compañías dependientes. Tenemos un lock-in tecnológico. ¿Cómo podemos trabajar con esto? Y también podemos ver que la planificación regional es demasiado lento. ¿Cómo podemos hacerlo en una mejor manera? ¿Cómo podemos trabajar con la legislatura? ¿Cómo podemos facilitar la planificación regional? Porque claro que es amenaza las inversiones en la región. Aquí hemos describido de la alianza triple hélice para la innovación. Se puede ver que las compañías, las innovaciones pasan entre las compañías muchas veces. Solamente 3% con las universidades. Claro que estas cifras son solamente de la cantidad de relaciones, no dicen nada de calidad. Yo creo que las relaciones con las universidades son pocas, pero son de muy buena calidad. Y por eso yo creo que no es perfectamente justo la figura, pero estamos trabajando en cómo medir la calidad también. Y hemos hecho unos estudios. Pero se puede ver esto, que podemos compararlo de un año a otro y ver lo que está pasando. Si se ve por tipo de resultados que recibimos con este modelo o de esta manera de trabajar, yo he robado un metáforo del Banco Mundial. Y si consideremos nosotros como jardineros de la política de innovación, se puede hacer 4 cosas: regar la planta, la limpieza de la maleza, fertilizar la planta y el preparar el terreno. Y si analizas los resultados que recibimos a través de este método, los mayores resultados son con el riego, o para el riego, o con el limpiar la maleza. Las compañías pueden muy bien identificar qué tipo de proyectos necesitamos y también qué tipo de legislación no funciona. Investigación y desarrollo tenemos unos resultados, pero al nivel muy general. Pero estamos trabajando con esto, pero es, también funciona muy bueno para nosotros, porque esa limpieza y regar la planta también corresponde a nuestros poderes o nuestra función. Es que la política de investigación es una política estatal en Finlandia. Observaciones sobre el proyecto. Aquí quizás que comentar es que el sector público quiere que venir con un pensamiento fuera de lo establecido. Es que este enfoque es que las compañías, en particular las multinacionales, lo entienden perfectamente. Si se hablan sobre los socios de innovación y qué hacen y qué deberían hacer. Eso no es tan claro para el sector público como en comparación con las compañías. También el concepto de sistema de innovación es elusivo para muchas partes interesadas que no es tan claro. Pero es todo que podemos confirmarlos en el diálogo, en los seminarios del enfoque. Y entonces, si se ve, eso es que la coordinación de triple hélice es claro que hacemos esas rondas, lo hemos hecho en 2013, 2015, y ahora estamos repitiendo en 2007, este otoño, el diálogo estructurado. Y luego tenemos un web de hélice cuádruple para comunicar los resultados. Claro que el diálogo es un diálogo cerrado, pero lo comunicamos abiertamente que esos son nuestros resultados y pensamos que tratamos que hacerlo por esto. Y luego hacemos un análisis por LFA o por marco lógico, es decir, cómo podemos combinar nuestros recursos, proyectos, financiamiento que tenemos con las brechas identificadas, qué podemos hacer. Eso es un análisis de sentido común. Y por eso MURRES es el siglo finlandés por los grupos de cooperación regionales y lo comunicamos a la representación estatal en la región y a los demás. Bueno, desafíos en el gobierno. Claro que tenemos diferentes perspectivas y por eso es muy bueno tener un modelo. No todos aceptan que la política finlandesa tradicionalmente ha sido una política basada en innovaciones de ciencia, de impulsada por las universidades y no impulsada por los negocios. Lo nuevo con la especialización inteligente en Europa es que se ha extendido la política a todas las regiones, pero también que se ha ampliado el concepto de innovación, de tomar en cuenta la innovación basada en la práctica. Y eso es algo nuevo que quizás todos todavía no han aceptado. Es claro que es una perspectiva complementaria, por supuesto. Y por claro que tenemos una rivalidad entre los departamentos gubernamentales, existe probablemente en todo el mundo, y especialmente durante tiempos de austeridad, que todos tienen que ir adelante con sus ideas, y eso es un desafío, por supuesto. Y también es hasta un cierto punto un problema político también, que los políticos tienden a favorecer industrias de atardecer. Hablamos de sunset y sunrise industries. Es claro que si tenemos una industria de sunset, ellos que van a perder su trabajo, tiene nombre y apellido y son muy activos en los procesos políticos. Y lo nuevo que sunrise no se sabe, o sea, es muy difícil intelectualmente verlo, pero también no tiene apoyo político como los empleadores todavía no existen. Y eso es hasta un cierto punto también un desafío en formular la política, porque estamos en una competición por los mismos recursos en el gobierno. Bueno, ¿qué sobre los indicadores de los resultados? Lo hacemos, analizamos las brechas, si son las mismas, si ha avanzado la discusión, qué tipo de brechas hemos solucionado, qué nuevas brechas tenemos, qué nuevos retos, y eso es todo que tenemos que seguir la discusión y la estructura y analizar la discusión y la reflexión sobre los problemas que tenemos. Y también estamos usando para el seguimiento el RCA, o ventaja comparativa revelada por Balassa. Es un índice que es muy simple, está que si Ostrobotnia exporta 5% de producto X, o digamos que Finlandia exporta 100% del producto X y Ostrobotnia tiene una exportación correspondiente a 10% del producto X, entonces el RCA tiene un valor de 2. Y entonces podemos comparar cómo está cambiando nuestros picos en un intertemporal, y también seguir cómo está el PIB por hora, cuánto producimos por hora en las industrias exportadoras, es cómo hemos movido en la formación de los gansos. Aquí más es algo que es producido sobre nuestro modelo, la experiencia, el libro que hemos hecho en 2014, existe también en una forma de un borrador ha sido traducido por los técnicos de la Universidad de Playa Ancha, Valparaíso, Chile. No es perfecto, pero porque claro que ellos no pueden entender el contexto finlandés, pero se puede entender todo lo esencial del borrador que existe en la red. Y aquí es una comparación con Laponia, algo que yo he escrito sobre nuestra experiencia de la práctica, y también un artículo para Praseya, que es catedrática, sobre en European Planning Studies, y más viene. Aquí, gracias por su atención. Yo tengo un video más, como los restos. Como el resto.
Smart specialization is a tool that regions in Europe use to come to terms with the challenges and changes they're facing. Some, like the region of Ostrobotnia in Finland, have a unique take that draws interested visitors from as far away as South America.
It's a relationship between Chile and Ostrobotnia, especially in topics of innovation. And this aspect for us is very useful. Especially the integration between the public sector, the academy, the private sector, and the community in general, all working together for some special goals.
At the heart of the successful innovation systems in place in Ostrobotnia lie the principles of smart specialization. This set of principles is the focus of discussions and development work all around Europe, and is seen as a unique opportunity for regions to innovate and grow.
Smart specialization strategies is one of the most important tools that we have right now for regional growth. What we're aiming for is growth through innovation. And in some cases, in most cases, the regional authorities and the public authorities have to take an active role in promoting this.
Through dedicated work, smart specialization has been implemented on a European level and has been fully embraced by key players in the west of Finland to great effect.
Now there is a new phase where transnational learning comes much closer to the innovation process within each region. And in this respect, Ostrobotnia has had a very forward, leading role, because we started very early with an S3 conference in Vasa and we have followed up that through the OAS Robotnian Council with gap analysis and connected to transnational learning between Finland, Norway, and now also in the Baltic Sea.
The constant challenge in the region of Ostrobotnia while working with smart specialization is to keep the national focus and support trained on the importance of regional innovation processes.
If you look on the Ostrobotnian innovation system, you have actors being employed by central government, you have actors that are regional actors, and you have actors also that are municipal actors. And then you have all the helixes represented. You have people from universities, people from companies, and people from the public sector, and even from the general public, NGOs. Now, they have different perspectives. They are all relevant perspectives, but you have to bring them together. In this way, the Ostrobotnia model is working because it provides the lenses or the spectacles that this is the way that we look at the innovation, how the innovation takes place. And that provides a point of reference for the actors that they may agree or they may not agree, but at least we know what we're discussing about.
We studied or we heard about the Ostrobotnia government talk to us about the model, the theoretic model, but also we can saw with our eyes the experience in the companies, the experience in with the government, with the experience with the university. It's incredible all the work you are doing in between three actors.
To find out more about Ostrobotnia's take on smart specialization, please follow this link.
Gracias también. Orain hirugarrengo kasuari emango dio hasiera, baina lehenik bai esan nahi dizuet honen ondoren dialogo bat egongoa, elkarrizketa bat egongoa hizlari guztiekin eta zueke galderakteko aukera izango duzue, beraz galderari bai duzue gorde apuntatu eta gero bai hitza emango dizuegula galderak egiteko. Bueno, hirugarren kasua, Christoph Ray Schmidt is here with us. And he's from Business Upper Austria. He's the coordinator of third-party funded projects on national and international level and responsible for international project development and international affairs. Additionally, he oversaw EU projects such as the European Cluster Collaboration Platform, the European Cluster Excellence Initiative, Clustrat, or SME internationalization through clusters. He's benchmarking expert, silver and gold label assessor, trainer of the European Foundation of Cluster Excellence, member of the Technical Advisory Board of the European Secretariat of Cluster Analysis, and is conducting a vast variety of cluster management trainings and service development. And he's a renowned speaker within and outside Europe. So please, thank you.
So, a very warm welcome from my side, and thank you very much for having me here. It's a real pleasure to be here. It's my second time in the Basque Country. I think back in 2012 I was here in the course of the TCI conference, and I still remember this place as really outstanding, and I enjoy having the possibility to be here. Basically, where I'm from, I think everybody is from the heart of Europe, as you are, we are, and we are in Upper Austria also from the heart of Europe. And Upper Austria is quite a little area which accounts for 1.4 million inhabitants. And basically, Austria has around about 8 million inhabitants. So we account for 70% of the population, but for 25% of Austrian industrial production and 28% of Austrian exports. So we can say we are a little bit the powerhouse of this field. And basically, before I want to go a little bit more in detail on the smart specialization strategies, what issues we were addressing and what maybe also challenges we were addressing, I want to go a little bit more in detail about our company. I'm from the business agency of Upper Austria, and our idea is more or less being the one-stop shop if it comes to business ideas and bringing them down to market. So as we already heard, so we want to have our companies in the driving seat if it comes to innovation, but also in close collaboration with research and bringing them together in the whole value chain. So basically, these are the core activities what we deal with. On the one hand, we had already the discussion that we are facing shortcomings if it comes to highly skilled people. And we in Upper Austria have the situation up to 3 years from now that we had more or less full employment rate. And right now we have almost around about 5% unemployment rate, but the problem is still the society is extremely changing and we cannot really catch up with the needs of the industry as we would like to do so. So one of our activities is to find skilled people from all over Europe to settle down in our area. We have in our clusters and networks around about 2,300 partner companies. These are companies who basically pay membership fees. So for us, a member is really somebody who's committing by paying and not just saying, I'm a member and signing some nice piece of paper, but really showing clear commitment. Basically, we have a department dealing also with promoting innovation. What does this practically mean? So if you want to go for an EU fund for specific funding schemes, we support them at writing the proposal, doing a checkup if the criteria are fulfilled, and so on, to increase the success rate of the companies. Another one is the topic of cooperative projects, where we bring companies together who cover different areas from the value chain, and we want to help them developing new technologies, new services, new business models in specific areas which are important. We support around about 30 startups annually, and we also conduct so-called supplier innovation days. What does that mean? We are the door opener for our companies, so we bring our companies to the headquarters of BMW, of Volkswagen, or for instance to Ford in the States, where they can present themselves in a one-day event to present their innovations to the key players. We had now a couple of months ago a supplier innovation day at SAPCO at Iran. So we also look out for areas which might be of interest in the future. At the moment, we are negotiating with Russia, but this is a little bit complicated right now. So we do not know if this will really finally work out. So it's a very broad area of activities. And also we support companies who are willing to settle down a premises in Upper Austria to find a location, to support them and guide them through the whole process of administrative issues to be quite easy and to settle down in our area easily. And because of our big boss is the Minister of Economics and Research, we have also direct access to politics if needed. So this is just a quick overview about some figures. As I said, we support companies to settle down in our areas. 60 really settle down annually, more or less. We have also a huge bunch of events what we organize, around about 300 a year with about 12,000 participants. Support the companies also in the field of intellectual property rights. This is an issue where we put a lot of emphasis on, because when we support cooperative projects between companies, we also have to make sure that they are on the safe side if it comes to cooperative issues, and not that there's a discussion at the end who belongs which part, and that might be a problem as such. As I said, 132 cooperative projects are supported, 30 startups, and a bunch of supplier innovation days, what we do annually. Here is just a brief overview about our structure of our business agency. And what might be of interest, we have more or less three departments who are at the front, at the customer. This is the department of the location management, which really go to the companies also abroad to bring them into Austria. and also the Department of Clusters and Networks, where we have now 8 clusters and a network, so quite a broad portfolio of activities and services. And then we have the department which is dealing with funding support. And parallel, what I marked a little bit in red is the Department of Strategy. This is the department which is responsible for the development of the smart specialization strategy of Upper Austria. So basically, we have more or less 2 departments, or more or less the departments on company level to really get to the knowledge from the companies, and parallel a department who's drafting then the smart specialization strategy. So to say, as we already had, to have the companies in the driving seat so they can really interfere and give their inputs if it comes to smart specialization ideas and approaches. A brief overview about our clusters. So we had around about 2,300 partners, mainly SMEs. And we conduct about 2,000 company visits each year, where we go out to the companies, identify their cooperation needs, bring them together then in joint cooperative projects. And since 1998, when the first cluster was set up, this was the automotive cluster, we have done more than 529 cooperative projects, like technology development mainly. On the right side, you find the key issues where we are actually focusing on. And interestingly, these key fields where we are focusing on are also in line with the smart specialization strategy of our area. And it comes to light that we have, on the one hand, our different clusters from the automotive, plastics, mechatronics, timber and furniture, medical technology, clean tech, ICT, human resources, food, and also Software Park Hagenberg. It's a university of applied science and also a business incubator. And they have, on the one hand, their standardized value chains, but also cross-cooperate between different topics. For instance, our automotive cluster is really strong in the field of automotive autonomous driving or smart mobility. This is a big issue where we focus on in the field of the mechatronics cluster is strongly focusing on the field of advanced manufacturing, where we also developed a specific maturity model where we can measure the readiness level of companies in the field of advanced manufacturing, identify where they should be or should develop to, and when we have identified the specific gap, we can derive trainings for them how they can improve and get better off. And this is also in joint cooperation with universities in our area as such, so where we really bring the knowledge of our industry jointly together with our universities. In the field of medical technology, we help companies who have nothing to do with the medical field to enter the medical field. It can be the field of ICT or whatever, but often you have huge hurdles in this field, in the medical field, to enter it. And here we have different tools and support schemes that we can help them to enter this specific field. Then we have circular economy as a big issue, big data, food and packaging, so a broad field where the different clusters focus on. And each cluster has an own advisory board, up to 12 people, mainly from industry, and 2 or 3 professors from academia, so that we can really see, be at the forefront of innovation, that the universities can tell us where we have to focus on, and on the other hand, the company knowledge is also integrated respectively. We are also gold-labeled clusters and also focused on international activities ranging from around about 40 EU projects or national projects annually, or I think right now we have running 35. We initiate or are involved in lectures and different international activities, so we have a broad portfolio of international activities, but not just on an intermediary level, but also for our companies as such. But I think the best thing what can happen to you, and I think we had it already, is a good crisis, because it forces you to question you, to think out of the box, and to do something different. I think one, it's what is it quite dangerous when you are already playing in the Champions League. You do not know that, or you're not capable to be the winner of the Champions League, but still, well, you're always in the Champions League, so no need to change because the rest is much weaker than you are. So I think this is the but if you are really on a very low level, then you always have new goals and you question your approaches all the time. And I think to being good but not really, let's say, top of the food chain is, I think, most dangerous field, where, because you do not question your approaches too much, and this could be a possibility then really to avoid that you get down there as we were. It was also a crisis in the 80s and at the beginning of the 90s, where our steel industry had big problems. They had to lay off people. We had strong labor unions, and they were not really ready for change as such. And now it changed the other way around. So we have, for instance, the First Alpine, which is one of the world market leader in specific steel areas. We have, if you are driving a BMW of the 5 or 7 series, then more or less your engine is developed and produced in Steyr. So all the diesel engines in this field are developed and produced in Steyr. But also in other niches, when you look at firefighting cars from Rosenbauer, they are produced and developed also in Upper Austria. So a broad area of bigger and smaller world market leaders. And the question is, what actually happened that we catched up from this valley of death up to now? And I think the key thing is, and here I love this Chinese saying, is if the wind of change are blowing, some build walls, other windmills. And I really support the windmills approach. So really changing your perspective, looking out of the box, or being get rid of the box, and trying to find new approaches and new solutions. And how did we practically do it? Sorry. It was quite a lucky time, also in the middle of the 90s, when three people from our area sat together. This was the Minister of Economics, the head of the Chamber of Commerce, and the head of the Chamber of Industrialists, and said, well, we have a big crisis. We want to get in more independence from the central government in Vienna, and what can we do? So they came across the books of Porter, and this idea of, back then it wasn't called smart specialization, but focusing on your strength areas and agglomerating the knowledge. And they said, well, this could be an approach what we want to follow. So basically, there were different issues one had to think about. First, you need a vision and a clear visionary thinking where you want to develop your areas, but you have to overcome a bunch of so-called gaps. If you want to make your companies ready for the future, it is very important that the research or the research does understand the needs of the industry, and that they give more or less you the knowledge that you can catch up from an industrial perspective as well, that they train the right people for you, and that you have really the skilled people on stake if it's needed. But also that you have the right funding schemes and capital possibilities to get the money, the funding support, and so on, if it's needed to really take the next step if it comes to innovation. Another issue is the government gap. You need access to government, to governmental support structures, and it's in our case we have more or less direct access to our minister. So consequently, when we have the feedback of our 2,300 companies and say, well, they are really facing these and these challenges, because we do customer satisfaction analyses on a regular basis, we can really reflect and discuss with them and say, well, I think we need some adaptations in the one field or the other. And there is the need for cooperation between the companies as well, including having a international perspective, and what we heard earlier before, if really the regional powerhouses of Europe more or less work together, it's sometimes even easier than cooperating maybe with your neighboring region in your own country. So it can be helpful also to look into other countries, what they learned and share best and in particular worst practice cases. Here I just summarized some ideas, and it's just not focusing on cluster strategy, but generally also on smart specialization strategy. There has to be a knowledge, good knowledge between the different areas and fields which cooperate together, a dense network or also a joint language of understanding, and also also positive incentives. Why should I actually work together? What is my benefit that I share knowledge with another one who might benefit from my knowledge? What do I get back from him? And here we have a bit of a mentality in Upper Austria, as if the neighbor's house is burning down, I help him shutting down the fire instead of just being happy that my house is not affected. So basically supporting each other in this respect is quite helpful. And see these points, I think, can be quite helpful to set up a respective smart specialization strategy. We started doing research to identify the areas where we are actually strong in. One counts for the average level of specialization all over Austria. 1.5 accounts for the average level of specialization in Upper Austria. And then we looked at the area where we were in particular strong. You might ask, you, and in the majority of them, we set up clusters, cluster management organizations over the time. And you might maybe ask yourself why we haven't set anything up in the field of textiles and clothing. And the interesting thing is we looked on the one hand on our strength areas, but also the fields where we thought here we will be really even strong in 10 or 15 years from now. And maybe if we would do this kind of study again, we wouldn't get rid of the textile field right now, because while with smart textiles and so on, it's really a big issue. But back in the middle of the 90s, we thought, well, it will be anyway produced by the Chinese, so it's not our business anymore. Even so, we are that strong, and we still have with Lenzing AG also a very, very strong company in that area. But yeah, this is the thing. So not just focusing on the areas where we are strong right now, but where we also see possibilities for the future. When we did all this research, we then started implementing the first strategic program back in 1998. And right now we are running the so-called fourth strategic program. All these strategic programs set up on the previous strategic program, and the first one was focusing very much on the things like technology, professional qualification, and location marketing, but also in particular on setting up a cluster management organization. So this was more or less setting up clusters as such, followed by the next step, which was extremely interactive, where we had interaction with more than 250 experts in specific areas, stakeholders, to identify the fields where we should focus on funding schemes, on etc. And also we put a lot of emphasis on the professionalization of our cluster organizations, followed by the third strategic program, which then put a lot of emphasis on mechatronics, ICT, life science, innovative materials, logistics, renewable energy. And this is more or less the strategic program as it looks right now, because first of all, we try to look out of the box. So we looked, what is Europe doing, to say also they have the H 2020, they have the grand societal challenges to tackle. And also we integrated the research, the Council of Research, Technology and Development. It's an advisory board of the Austrian government in the field of innovation. And these are people who are not paid for their work, but really do it on a voluntary basis. And they cover the whole field. They are from research, they are from business, and so on. So quite a broad range range of fields Rx are represented, and there is also a Council for Research and Technology on Upper Austrian area level, and this covers then, for instance, representatives of the universities of applied science, universities, then also issues such as industry representatives, but also intermediaries, and they try to challenge our government with good ideas, innovative approaches, and so on, where we should put our emphasis on. And it was always clear that we focus on production in a wider range because, well, this is more or less the backbone of our industry. And basically, at the end, these four core strategies have been identified: location development, industrial market leadership, internationalization, future and emerging technologies. And I try to get a little bit more in depth what this actually means. Location development is on the one hand an approach for scientific people, but on the other hand also for business, really to bring the best business minds here to Upper Austria, but also from a scientific point of view, and here again focusing on our core strengths and core competences. But also we want to be really a knowledge-based business, focus on knowledge-based business models, and also to adapt our production processes very much. So if the topic of advanced manufacturing is a very crucial issue, so we had, for instance, some years ago in 2012, a conference on megatrends. So we set up a conference on megatrends but didn't really focus on something specific. And then this was really cool because we invited the key politicians, also the Vice Chancellor of Austria was there, the ministers and so on, and also from industry. And then Elga Fleisch, a professor from ETH Zürich, who was more or less the godfather of augmented reality, held the speech there and told us more or less, if you don't deal with this issue and do not catch up on this topic of advanced manufacturing, you can shut down Upper Austria. So it was really quite an issue. And this really caused a lot of dynamic also in our area to say, well, we have to do something on this. So we in our cluster had one person who was then exclusively dealing with this topic of advanced manufacturing, doing research on the different topics, going to the cradles of, driving to the cradles of advanced manufacturing, like Rüschlikon or Kaiserslautern and so on, and always brought our ministers, our industry, and also the media with them to really get some momentum on this issue. And later on, derived from these, let's say, smart specialization strategy, where we also focused industrial market leaderships, or later on also on future emerging technologies, we focused, or more or less we set up funding schemes who exclusively helped our companies to catch up on this. On the one hand, bringing people from education to the industry, so they were trained in the field of advanced mechatronics, advanced manufacturing, and then there's a funding scheme bringing these students at the end of their studies to the companies to make them ready for advanced manufacturing, and where they also have then more or less a coach who is joining them for the process so that they can help the companies to get advanced manufacturing ready. So internationalization is also a very, very important field for us, where we want to exchange with very strong areas, strong regions, learn from the best, and also catch up in areas where we still see a lot of level of improvement, but which we identify as also core important areas. And so I think long-lasting sustainable cooperations between important areas is quite crucial. I don't know. So, finally, five fields of activities have been identified. These were the topics of industrial production processes, energy, health and aging society, food, nutrition, and mobility and logistics. And in these fields, how did we identify the activities there? And we, first of all, had on the one hand a top-down and bottom-up stakeholder process on the, with the different boards and councils, but also we try to align them with the activities on European level and also be aware that this whole value chain or this whole innovation chain, education, research, and economy should be integrated. And also for us it was very important that these fields of activities were so precise with clear topics and measures that we could really get something on the ground and not just more or less stopping on some level and say we are now smart and specialized, but we do not really know how to get something out of it or do not know what we finally get out of our activities. This is more or less one slide where I try to bring all these different activities together. So we have on the one hand these five core activities like industrial production processes, energy and so on and so forth. Then the three activities like education, research and economy. And then bringing them together with key activities, what we do and everything embedded in the whole approach of digitalization, which we see as one of our backbones of the future. And I can give you one example where we tried for in the field of education, because we try to get stronger and stronger in the primary, secondary, and tertiary education. We set up, we went to the Austrian railway organization and asked them if we can have a not a train, but the where we all sit in, I don't know how to call it, doesn't matter, so such a piece of a train. And then we went to the first Alpine and said, well, do you provide us a place where we can put this kind of wagon, this wagon? And our idea was, we set up a more or less, and then went to the industry, and they filled it in with a lot of technology and so on and so forth. And now the students are running this kind of wagon. So they train other students, like pupils from other grades, in this specific technologies and so on. So it's like run by pupils, and they train pupils from other areas and from other levels. So our idea was to bring them together with technology and to inspire them that technology is nothing, not like some complex thing, but something which makes really fun and where we should really push our emphasis on. So the idea was really to start from the early beginning with the pupils, bringing industry in it, matching the different research fields together, and to get out of the silos and to cooperate. And after more or less 2 years, we will put this wagon to another place. We haven't decided yet to which one, and we will fill it up with other topics and so on, but the key idea will continue as such. I don't know, I'm pushing very enthusiastic today. Okay, but anyway, still too much energy. So this is one slide which gives you a quick overview about what this whole system looks like. So we have on the one hand our topics, like the core strategies such as industrial production processes, internationalization. They are all supported by this triple helix and feeded in our key areas for the future. And what we tried now was to set up so-called funding schemes for these five key areas to get it on the ground. I don't know. But anyway. But before we, I want to share with you the process, how this strategic program, the last one, has been set up. So we were involved in this S3 platform, so we already registered it back in 2011, then got great support from the people from the OECD who had a workshop with us jointly in Upper Austria, and to identify, are we barking up the wrong tree or are we on the right track regarding our ideas, what we had on our strategic program. Then, based on the feedback we received from them, we started to develop the strategic program and also did first stakeholder meetings where we integrated all the different key players to identify what are their thoughts, what their ideas, what are their missions, and how does it fit to the previous projects or strategic program as such. And then we did a call for expression of interest where everybody, all companies, all intermediaries could come up with clear ideas, clear focuses, clear project ideas, what they want to have supported in the upcoming years. And we got a response of more than 550 ideas and approaches. Based on this, we continued developing our project or our program, and then we asked the Austrian Research Institute and the UNEUM Research, two national big organizations, to evaluate our project program, if this fits or if there are some areas we should focus more or less or so on. The feedback was quite fine, and consequently we could quickly start with the program. And right now we are in the evaluation process of the program, already got quite some feedback, but it's not formally published yet, so nothing I can share right now. but it was fine, so was not a complete was quite okay. And in the course of more or less starting from 2014, or let's say at the beginning of 2015, we launched specific calls where the companies could, or also research institutes could apply to get funds in specific core fields of strengths to get more or less the industry adapted or getting research done. And this is more or less one of the calls. One of the calls was starting in spring 2015. It was a joint call between two fields, the industrial production processes and mobility and logistics. And by that time, 28 projects applications we received, 10 finally funded, and this covered a volume of 4.1 million, a funding scheme or funding rate of 75%. And we made sure that the evaluation is done on Austrian level, not on upper Austrian level, by the Austrian Promotion Agency. And they are also responsible for more or less monitoring the whole funding scheme, so that we are out of the system. Because otherwise, somebody says, "Well, you're just supporting my friend," and so it's nothing obvious. So here we tried to step back a bit. The next one was a call dealing with health and aging society. Also, we received 19 project applications. 8 of them finally were approved. The project volume of 1.5 million. And also 75% funding rate. The funding rate sometimes varies a bit depending on more or less who's the leader of the application. So research institutes get a higher one. Small and medium-sized companies get also a pretty high one. If it's a bigger company, it can be reduced. So it's a little bit more complex than these couple of slides, but just as a first impression for you. And also centralized, managed from Austria. And then we did. Then there was still an additional call dealing with mobility. And here we managed to set up the first, let's say, cross-border, but officially cross-regional call between Upper Austria and Styria, so to have more critical mass, because in the field of logistics and automotive, Styria is extremely strong, as we are, and then we thought it makes more sense if we pool sources in this regard and generate a joint call. But it's interesting, because then you need not just our Minister of Economics and Research who's saying, well, we go for this, but you need another Minister of Economics and maybe additional research and to say, well, that maybe Styrian money is going to Upper Austria and the other way around. So there are some issues to make sure that everything is running well there. But so more or less a project volume of 4 million euros could be approved. And right now the system is that we have more or less launched 160 million if it comes to research and business-related volume. And overall, the whole project had then a volume of 1.5 billion euros because the industry was heavily investing in these kind of approaches and funding schemes. And in total, because there were specific funding schemes who were exclusively then on education-related fundings, maybe also in the field what I told you with this train approach or so, these were then something with also 140 million. So basically, we could generate 275 million euros from public funds and overall a volume of more than 1.5 billion. I think I'm already almost done, because this I wanted to skip anyway. So if you have any questions, and I do not want to fight with you because of the break later on, so I want to be quick. Maybe then we are ready for questions, and you are earlier in the lunchtime. So thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Christoph. Orain hasiko gea galdera saioarekin. Orduan, galdera igualin badezu emesez eskualtza edo nola baita zaldu. Eta galdera kiteko bildurrik gabein euskera, zerdera, zede inglesez, nahi zuena, eta itzulpenekin moldatuko gea. Entonces decía que vamos a empezar el diálogo, que Paolo va a coordinar. Entonces I invite you all to the stage so you can start the conversation that Paolo will coordinate. Thank you. Yes, yes.
I have to switch this on. Ah, no, it's already on. Oh, perfect. Thank you very much. I think we got very interesting presentations this morning. A lot of questions, I think, on out of these presentations. And I would like to start with some questions to the friends here, but I want also you to raise questions to the presenters, so to have a more interaction than an internal discussion among us, which is wouldn't make, I think, that much sense. But just to break the ice, I have a question which is for every one of you, but I will start with luck. With the luck, since you were the first one, and what impressed me in dealing with all the process of transformation, all the innovation process, what actually was remarkable, in my opinion, is the need of having a persisting effort over the time. No? Very often, this is instead is something which is not happening that much. And so there are discontinuities that are eventually affecting the possibility to actually have a long-term perspective and vision. So what were the key elements, key favorable factors, or also on the other end, the mind constraints you faced in dealing with all the transformation of the local system, as you mentioned?
Well, I think it's very important to have the collaboration of all the parties involved. So the triple helix approach with the companies and the local government and the universities. But I think it always is very important to have the organization power. You call it the powerhouse, but somebody has to pay for all those efforts. And it's very, we were talking about triple helix, but it's very interesting. The development company I'm working for is paid by the cities. The cities contribute every year from a percent of the tax coming into the cities. They contribute to the development company to have an organization power to create this collaboration. doesn't go by itself. You need to have an organization who facilitates, who brings people together. All the companies, all the universities are very busy with running their own business. And so I think it's very unique that the municipalities contribute to the regional collaboration. And it's very important, because when you don't have this organization power, it's going to be very difficult. And also, you have to work at different levels, so your own region, the 6 regions, the 2 provinces. And from this BrainPort network, you collaborate with The Hague, the political center of Holland, and also with the province involved. We always look to the cross-border cooperation, because that's the issue. We had a big castle meeting with our friends from Belgium. We said, well, we can work together without those national governments. Why always look at The Hague or look at Brussels? We can collaborate with our regions itself. So great development in the organization power, and to look behind your own borders and seek the collaboration. So that's, I think, the key issues we are dealing with.
Thank you very much. I don't know whether there are some questions from the participants, some comments. Meanwhile, we are okay, please.
Una pregunta para Christoph. Bien, ha citado que han propuesto 19 proyectos sobre el tema del envejecimiento de la población por un volumen de 1,5 millones de euros. Me gustaría conocer ese proyecto de envejecimiento, qué apartados tiene o qué capítulos contempla. Gracias.
Basically, the idea of this is generally, or to start a little bit broader, what we want to achieve in this field. We on the one hand set up a university or medical faculty in Linz, so we are more or less also the link between industry and our research. And so our idea here in this project, or one of this topic, is, as I already addressed, to bring companies who are not related to the medical field into the medical field. So in this project, we deal with reducing hurdles or discussing on legal issues. So how can we bring the companies in, or for instance, having the possibility for companies to test specific things in a more or less protected environment, if it works out or not, and to test it. So it's the focus is on the one hand on this aging society, but this covers, for instance, to be even more precise, the topic that we have to make sure that the aging, so that the people can stay at home as long as possible before being having to live in old people's houses or being more or less sent to hospitals. So to help them with technologies and solutions to stay safe at home as possible. And this covers then a quite broad range of different activities, but mainly helping people or technologies who are not yet in the healthcare field to enter.
Okay. It's okay? Do you have some far comment?
Yes, one more question.
Yes. Okay. Yeah, please.
Yes, okay. Yes, I was comment that in this effort to profit all the experience that we can find in the different organizations, industries, governments, and so, no? The problem is always how to manage, how to profit the different levels of knowledge that we find in the different organizations. I mean, technical knowledge, expert knowledge, and basic knowledge, no? And for us, is I think in the society, in the knowledge society, it's very important to find the strategies to profit these different levels that exist in all the organizations. No? The question for everybody is: do you know, or have you developed, or is there any experience or program to face this kind of problem?
Yes, you.
Well, it is of course a very, very, it's a big problem, and I think you have to organize it with different types of methodologies, because usually if somebody gives me a good piece of advice, it takes some time before I realize that it was a good advice, usually after the project. and I think that goes for very, very much of the persons, and I think that you have the Seki technology or the method of Nonaka, and then you have to organize it formally, and you have to have a structured transfer of knowledge as a complement of the transfer of knowledge that happens spontaneously. So I think you have to put resources into it, because it's just not a question of showing something or having a seminar, but it's a question of analyzing the practices, analyzing the whys between the practices, and then to work in a systematic way with the partners that you are considering relevant. So I think it has to be organized in a form of transnational learning, complementing a spontaneous change of knowledge. Then it would happen like a form of a knowledge spiral that more and more people realize the ideas that were brought forward. So it takes time, but I think you have to organize it.
If I have something on that, if I may, I would say that there was someone who also mentioned the fact that apparently you were the one, that apparently are sharing the same language, but this is not actually what is happening. The wording is the same, but the meaning and the understanding of the same wording is different. This means that from building up a capacity to have a different level of knowledge shared and mixed in a sound way, often there is a role which is played by a catalyzer, a facilitator, someone, some institution, somebody, some people who are actually acting in between, facilitating, establishing real substantial communication. And very often this is the way for enabling some dynamics happening, because the ingredients are there, but there is no one able to cook the cake as at once because of the lack of the chief working on that. I think this is also a point which is relevant in the case where this is working, no? And I think these cases are cases where this was doing.
No, it's true.
De nuevo, para el señor Christophe, usted ha mencionado el tema del envejecimiento y no ha citado más que el tema de la salud. No ha citado ningún otro tema. Y yo quisiera hacer una pregunta concretada con esta. Han hablado ustedes de importantes proyectos de movilidad. Dado que aquí se va a hacer un centro también de envejecimiento en Pasajes, como ha mencionado el señor diputado general, me gustaría saber, en el área de la movilidad, si han tenido el foco mirado en hacer ciudades más amigables para las personas mayores, ha mejorado el tema de transportes que sea para personas que tengan problemas de discapacidad, etcétera, etcétera. Nada más.
Thank you very much for the question. It is really, in this case, it's mainly a topic which is dealt with our automotive cluster, which is then talking about or dealing with this topic of connected mobility and autonomous driving. And this, for instance, deals with many of these issues. This deals, for instance, with when I'm driving autonomous and my car doesn't have any sound, that people who are maybe, for instance, disabled or who are blind, what can happen so that they are on the safe side. So, and also the system, where can I store my car, smart parking, and all these different issues, so that I can reduce traffic in the city as such, and make a better, let's say. Life for the people there. So this is then a topic which is more or less a 360 degrees point of view on mobility as such, where the topic of like aging society is a very, very crucial issue, but which we in the field of healthcare right now do not really tackle that much. But maybe to give you an example so that it shows that these different areas are not disconnected, we have all our different clusters and networks located under one roof, and they are all on one floor, and we share one coffee machine where the people come together and exchange on specific issues, challenges, and try to cooperate on specific things. So basically, then we had an example with the timber and furniture cluster and the automotive cluster, for instance, that there was a new directive from the automotive car producers. And they told us, well, the cars, the doors have to close in this specific way, and our producers weren't capable to do so. And then they exchanged with the people from the timber and furniture cluster, and they had solutions for this specific issue to say, well, you have to do these and these specific things to fulfill the criteria. So meaning that in explicitly the topic of autonomous driving and connected mobility is not really explicitly highlighting exclusively the topic of, let's say, aging society, but it is a very, very crucial issue in this respect. And just to hopefully answer your question in that way.
Thank you very much for all your presentations. I'm going to make it in Spanish. Mi pregunta va dirigida para Jerker Johnson, pero me gustaría también que la complementaran nuestros otros invitados. Es en relación a las regiones como puntos focales de aprendizaje y estas cuestiones que se han presentado a lo largo de la mañana, pero sobre todo la habilidad que tendrían las regiones para desbloquear, vamos a utilizar esa palabra, desbloquear determinados recursos que tal vez pasan desapercibidos y que pueden aportar al discurso de desarrollo y de construcción pues un valor añadido diferenciado y de calidad. Esto tiene mucho que ver con las resistencias, muchas veces, con los bloqueos que tenemos dentro de las regiones y las nuevas configuraciones que casi siempre se basan en una nueva gobernanza. En este sentido, ¿alguna experiencia, anécdota que podáis aportarnos? Gracias.
Yes, I mean, there's two elements of the problem. I mean, if you look into lock-in or you look into the focal groups where we are discussing the problems of the gaps, and then you look into the lock-in situations, you would have two types of lock-ins. You would have a type of lock-in where the companies are not able to be exported themselves, but they are depending on other companies. Then you could have a political lock-in as well, that you are not only that ideas doesn't advance, that you don't work in new ways, you're not taking on board smart specialization, but you are maybe smart washing your old strategies, old ways of working. Now, for the companies, it is very difficult because when they have time, they don't have money, and when they have money, they don't have time. And this is a problem, and I think here comes the ways of trying to look to it, to different projects. I also believe very much in transnational learning. A small region, if you work with the smart specialization, we will learn from other regions, because we will understand what the platform is saying, we will understand what they're doing in the other regions, because we speak the same language. So I think these ways of working, ways of solving it, we have done things with the Internet of Things, we have tried to do different things, but we would be very much open to look into how to break an economic lock-in. Then if you look into the political lock-in, change is not necessarily coming from your organization. I mean, if I've been working with something for 20 years, and if somebody comes up with something very smart, of course I will ask that, why didn't I think on that myself for 18 years ago? And in this way, I think that you have to build a partnership of entrepreneurs or those who are interested in these questions and in these things, and start to develop it. I think also that international partnerships are very good. If the same people discuss the same things as they've been doing for 20 past years, they are maybe likely to come into with the same solutions. But if you bring somebody in from outside, everybody will do a little bit better. And also different ideas. You have to have a mentality open to this. This has to do with structures and cultures. In Finland, we are always thinking on why are the Swedes doing better than we are? And that is always a problem for us, sort of, that when we grow with 1%, they grow with 2%, and we would like to go with 3%. But I think one of the secrets, I think, in Sweden is an organizational culture. You listen to youth, you listen to young people, you listen to new employees, you are less hierarchical. These are all questions that are very much linked to preparing the ground. So summarizing, I think that in the companies, I think you have to recognize the problem. I think that you can look on how other people are doing. I think transnational partnerships will bring new ideas. The political process, the same thing almost. That you have to build a partnership for those who are motivated by change and see these possibilities in this. And of course, in any change, there will be resistance. I mean, the resistance is likely to come from science. I mean, all universities are say that innovation is the same as more research, especially when we are reducing budgets all the time. So it's not a resistance-free political change. Yes.
There are some additional comments.
Well, maybe just one. So I fully agree. Maybe to add one specific thing, what we do to overcome or one idea to overcome such resistance in specific areas. To start with a little example, we have the Rosenbauer. This is the world market leader for firefighting cars. And they are running two production chains next to each other. They produce the same car. And the one production chain, there are most probably, I would say, last time when I was there, maybe 80 people working. And in the other, maybe 3 or 2 or 4, something like this. So the one thing is completely automatized. The others is very, very much with handcraft thing. And the question is, what will they do? So Rosenbauer will definitely go for the thing which makes them most competitive. And in the worst case, they have to lay off people. And that's an issue. So we set up a kind of, as I said already, this kind of maturity model where we measure the readiness level. We develop specifically a human resource-related maturity model on the field of advanced manufacturing, meaning to identify in a very, very early stage What does it mean for a company who wants to become ready for advanced manufacturing, which skills they need, what skills the people who are already involved in the companies have, and how to manage these kind of gaps? So how can we either find, make them ready for this change, find other opportunities, and so on? And we are far away from having a solution for it because, well, 80 people there, 3 there, it's quite a gap. But this is something where we at least work on and try to help to find possibilities to support the staff, not to, to oppose this kind of change completely, but to adapt to it. And then there are also, I think, big questions on political sides, like what kind of social system do we want, how, which kind of adaptations do we want, where do we get our taxes from, so I think these are then have then to be decided on other levels. So then, well, but this is, can really change the paradigm in a very, very broad range.
Hola, gracias. Yo tenía una pregunta relativa a, en todos estos equipos de trabajo, en los casos que se han expuesto, parece que uno de los papeles clave que tienen los integrantes del grupo es la universidad, ¿no? La investigación y la propia universidad. Entonces, aquí en nuestra experiencia del País Vasco, en la universidad que tenemos, se ve claramente esta implicación de la universidad en una, por ejemplo, que es la Universidad de Mondragón, que es una universidad ligada a una corporación corporativa, ¿no? Entonces parece que ahí la universidad, la investigación, sí que está más centrada en servir a los intereses de la propia sector productivo que tiene, ¿no? Lo que me gustaría saber es cómo se consigue que una universidad que puede estar o no ligada a los intereses productivos o comerciales de un país, ¿cómo se consigue que se ligue tan directamente a los intereses de la región, por ejemplo, en sus casos, ¿no? ¿Cómo han conseguido que la universidad pública, por ejemplo, que pueda estar haciendo su propia investigación, ligada o no, no sé, al sector productivo, se implique de esta forma tan directa al sector productivo? Si se hace por invitación, se buscan los agentes que estén más ligados a las áreas que se quieren desarrollar, ¿cuál ha sido su experiencia en ese sentido?
In Finland, we are following the German system, and with that we have the University of Applied Science that they are mixing practice with experience based, and we made a gap analysis, and if you go to the handbook of implementing smart specialization, here is from page 84 to 86 we're describing on how we worked with Norway. That we are piloting an experience, this experience in Norway, because in the gap analysis they showed to be very, very well working. Now, on a more general level, to answer the question that you have curiosity-driven research and you have demand-driven research, and there are two sides of the coin, so they're both needed, of course, but the curiosity-driven research should stand by academic merits. That somebody says that you have a referee saying that this is a good research that we will finance it, and the demand-driven research should be financed by the demand. So it doesn't have to be good, but it has to be needed in a way. The problem starts when curiosity-driven research comes to the region and saying the region needs this because it has not been financed by the academic sources. So. It's I see this as two sides of the coin that you should not mix. In a word, if you go for science, it is very good, and then you should be judged by the academic merits on it, but by in a process. If you go for being connected with the region, you should be judged by the demand, but the problem is when these are getting mixed.
We have also a lot of effort in building campuses, so the high-tech campus in Eindhoven and the Chemnitz campus in Limburg, where all the three parties are involved. So the companies on the campus in Eindhoven, there are working 8,000 people of companies of the university, work together with a lot of different nationalities. And that's the collaboration to invest in research and development. We got some knowledge institutions derived from the universities. And I think that works very well. And also university stimulates the companies in one way. They believe very much in what I told the photonics, to work with light in the future. So now the question is addressed to the companies, how can we do this together? And ASML, one of the big companies, is asking university, well, what's the next stage of real fundamental research and then working together with the applied sciences. So it's a real mix with company demand, fundamental research, and working together, for example, in campuses with the students and the PhDs to develop the new techniques and to innovate together. So that makes up. It's not easy. It takes a long time, but that's the way it works in the South of Netherlands.
To say something, and it's also a question that what you are we are saying right now is that actually your system is working as a regional innovation ecosystem. Yeah. In most cases, there is an assumption that there is an innovation ecosystem working, but in fact it's not, because of some silos thinking, rules where it's difficult to break down, no? Usually they're resistant to change. And according to your opinion, what are your experience? What are the key elements that are actually enabling a system becoming a regional innovation ecosystem? What are the key players, the key factors that are enabling that to happen, in your cases, that to happen?
That's
not an easy one.
pretty good question, actually. Not that easy. And I think it's actually all about people, because the thing is, when you take the example of Upper Austria, and we have like 1.4 million inhabitants, and we would take the assumption that everybody, that we know everything in our little ecosystem, and that we can do everything on our own, I think we are definitely barking up the wrong tree. So basically, we need corporations with different areas, also outside Austria. Austria has just 8 million inhabitants, so even Austria as such cannot cover everything. So I think we need in the core driving seats of like politics, of research, of industry, really the open-minded people who say, well, it would be nice to have the second, the third, or the fourth campus here, I don't know, in Linz, but maybe we don't go for it because the others in Vienna are better there and we pool our resources, or there are people in Munich who know it maybe even better and we cooperate in specific areas. And then it would be great to say we have our niche in specific areas of research in Upper Austria. There are the people in Munich who know it in this and that area better, and the others in the Netherlands are great in this field. And when we build up a cross-border ecosystem where we can send our students, our industry, to the experts in the Netherlands, they send the guys to us in Austria, and that would really, really bring something on the ground. And in this case, I think it's really you need such open-minded people who really, yeah, as I said, get rid of the box and not even just think out of the box.
Agree, and you have to focus on your strength. You can build a new ecosystem from something you haven't got in your region, and that's very important. Then the collaboration with other regions, so I mentioned, and tomorrow's also, I think, an item with some great programs like the Vanguard Initiative to work together with more regions, with 30 regions, from your ecosystem, working with the other ecosystems, like Christoph said, well, I think that's the future. my concern is, do we have the people to do all the work together? And we're suffering a problem with sufficient talent. So that's really a problem for the future. And I think that's always also a thing to discuss. How can we collaborate? We've got a training program with the Basque country, but perhaps we should do more in focusing on collaboration with exchange of talents.
Comment on it. Maybe through a crisis, if you look, for instance, in Basque country, I mean, you're considered as among the best in Europe, if you know about that, and in politics towards smart specialization and working system, and behind this lies a crisis, that you have an industrial crisis that you're facing. In Finland, we got too comfortable with Nokia, talking that we could always be the best in the world in Nokia, and then it falls down overnight, and then you have to start rethinking. And then it's a question of do you have an open-minded culture where you have an entrepreneurship that can, where the information flows of the possibilities, so the entrepreneurs can grab that, and what is our new ways of getting up. And so I think that you would have a flow of information and knowledge within the regions that reach the entrepreneurs, and then you have to have some of a collective understanding that this is not working anymore, we have to do something. And I think that would be sort of what you have to go for.
Una cuestión, me gustaría tocar una cuestión que ustedes han hablado, pero luego yo no he oído ninguna explicación concreta sobre el tema de la cogobernanza. Para nosotros es un tema francamente importante, es la participación, diríamos, de representantes, diríamos, del pueblo o civiles, diríamos, en la gobernanza. Simplemente a nivel indicativo, en Euskadi se ha aprobado una ley del tercer sector que de alguna manera faculta a los representantes sociales, que son en este momento el 80%, están organizados, a consultar o a tener el trato directo bien con el gobierno autonómico o con los gobiernos forales o con las juntas generales, que son los parlamentos también de aquí. Entonces, esto es un poco parecido a lo que a mí me explicaron hace unos años de cómo lo hacen en Dinamarca. Dinamarca parece que está organizado también por municipios de 3.000 habitantes, y las personas, participan y son consultadas en la aprobación de los presupuestos, de los proyectos, etcétera, etcétera. ¿Ustedes tienen algo por el estilo de eso?
As I said, with the smart specialization strategy there, it was exactly this process where the industry, but also representatives from different areas, research institutes and so on, were explicitly asked during drafting this kind of smart specialization strategy what kind of projects in particular you would like. So this was already very precise project ideas, and not just identifying the core strength areas, but more or less practically breaking it down to what kind of project it could be, so that the people who were really then finally drafting the smart specialization strategy and derived from this also the giving more or less the guidelines of how to apply and how to get these kind of funding schemes could more or less see where they should develop these kind of projects to. So the people from Upper Austria, or the industry as such, was already involved in this whole process of developing the smart specialization strategy, but not just on a meta level, but on a very precise level if it comes down to the field of projects.
There is one additional question I would like to raise for to complement this is, all this is usually done when the smart specialization strategy is in the stage of designing. What about the co-governance during the implementation? Because I think that when you are designing and conceiving something as a strategy, it's very good, and very often there are procedures, very open and so on. But the next day you have the strategy there in place and you start implementing it. How, in your experience, does it work, the continuous involvement and co-governance of the same strategy when it is in the making?
In our case, it's more or less always a one-year process. Where not then the companies as such are involved, but more or less like this, let's say, this more or less advisory board, what I mentioned, who gave advice to the politicians on regional and on national level, where key industrialists are represented, where the key people from research are involved as well. And then we have more or less the external evaluators on the regional and national level who are constantly involved where to adapt. But you're right, then it's not a broad process in this case if it's running, but really maybe then in this evaluation phases, then just like selected industrialists and so on are involved. But it's not such a big process as it was right at the beginning. And it will be the same, that it will be a very broad process from 2018 onwards when we will develop the new process. Yeah, so a more focused one.
We are looking into that problem as well. If you look in our approach, I mean, you are asking about the innovation network and you're asking about the expectations of the partners. Now, in order to answer that question, you have to be quite high up in the hierarchy. I have also worked, for instance, with Leader. I was a manager of Leader a long time ago. And there's a lot of strength in the Leader process because it builds on the village and it builds on empowerment of people. And we should have an open social process that complements this process, because this point is a very, very important one. But we are having a structured dialogue, and that structured dialogue is very difficult to open up. But we could try with a complementary dialogue. But before we start asking people and have participatory methods, we have to know how will we use the results, because that is using people's time in a wrong way if they come up with something and we don't take it into account. But I think that point is a very good one. I think it has to do with open social innovation. I think it could be a complementing thing that we should do in our approach as well, because I see the strength in it. We should also consider that smart specialization is the politics that is geared towards innovation. There may be other very important politics, say tourism or whatever, that you may consider as very important policy for the region, but where you are not expecting to find the innovations. So you have to separate between these two. But of course, to find solutions outside the box, you have to go outside the box maybe. So your point is a very valid one.
No, that's true. We're always talking about triple helix, and you mentioned also multi-helix, how to involve the population. Well, it's a challenge. Municipalities do a lot of this by meeting up with questionnaires. But it's very important to get everything aligned. I think the next challenge is also, we can talk about smart specialization, about funds, but now we see with the Brexit, and perhaps it's tomorrow the subject, but we have we're looking... What's the next period going to be? We have a struggle in Holland. We got 5 regions, and now the Dutch government. We have to talk with them and keep this regional policy. Don't combine all those funds to national funds, which sometimes is the issue now, because the funds are really getting very low. In South of Holland, we've got 100 million of regional fund for 7 years. So you can think about, is that we got such a big process meetings and a lot of meetings, is 100 million in 7 years, and then you have to to all kind of processes to get the projects funded. So there's a lot of discussion, and now the next phase is, that's very interesting now, is now we build our own regional strategy from the south of Holland. But let's now start building this regional strategy with our neighbors, with Belgium and with Germany together. And you, and I don't know if you know it, but you got 10% of your funds you can invest in France, and France can invest 10% in you. So that is really interesting for the next step, to combine your new strategic specialization with your neighbors, and then gain with the cooperation together. So that's new. The new agenda. Well, it's getting very interesting, because I think the funds are going down.
Definitely. There is one further and possibly final question, I think. So you are the lucky one.
A ver, tengo una pregunta concreta, porque en esas imágenes que se han puesto por dos de los ponentes de la antigua industria, ¿no? Y la, con ocasión de una crisis, la nueva industria, ¿no? La reconversión que ha habido, se ponía como una fuerza negativa, como algo que se dejó atrás, la fuerza de los sindicatos, ¿no? The strong work organizations, que se quedaron a un lado y impedían el cambio, ¿no? Y cómo el nuevo contexto posibilita el cambio. Mi pregunta es la siguiente. En este nuevo talento que se pide hoy en día, los nuevos titulados abiertos de mente que se contratan y que son tan necesarios, ¿están bien pagados en las regiones que ustedes representan? Porque aquí tenemos una, bueno, una mala noticia, o no sé, una buena y mala noticia, que es verdad que los sindicatos impedían el cambio, vamos a decir, ¿no? Se aferraban a los intereses que tenían y bueno, protegían a los intereses de los que tenían, pero nosotros ahora nos hemos pasado justo a la otra orilla, de forma que los nuevos talentos, los nuevos ingenieros e ingenieras hoy en día, pues cobran en las empresas como la señora de la limpieza del antiguo sistema, y luego además no tienen una jornada laboral, trabajan sin horas. ¿Esto les pasa también a ustedes en sus países?
Yes. Start. Okay.
Who takes the ball? Okay, I fully agree on what you said, that for us back in the 90s, it was or the 80s, it was definitely the case that key actors were more or less avoiding change as such. And by that time, these labor unions were like avoiding any kinds of structural change, which was definitely necessary. I think by now, and this was maybe also something what I tried to show a little bit with this idea of this approach, where we said we want to look on how the region is changing in the field of advanced manufacturing, but taking this human perspective in mind, we have really to ask ourselves, and it doesn't matter now if you are talking about labor units or whatever, what kind of society we want to have, because if everything is produced without people and we have a huge production sector with huge bunch of people and we do not need them anymore, we have to find other solutions as such. And I do not want to say we need labor unions or not, so that's not my issue. But I think we need in our society some ideas how to tackle these kind of changes, that there is a social link that we think, okay, it's worth working together, and that I'm fairly paid for the work and so on. So it cannot be the case that it's expected that everybody works 60 hours a week, parallel loses its job each day, and then still being happy for having a job on daily basis. So I do not talk pro or contra a specific group, but I think that generally that this is a big question and a big challenge, not for just a region or a country, but or even on European level. How can we secure our social system as such, and to make it ready for the future? And I frankly say I do not have a solution for that either.
I was coming here yesterday, so I went to the beach and I had a book about Donald Trump that I was reading, and what has happened in the United States, in Great Britain, and to a lesser extent in Europe, is that the rich has gone richer and the poor has gone poorer. And it is, of course, I mean, you have tax havens, you have bigger income disparities, as pointed out by the French economist Piketty, and with this, force the trust in society. Now, how to work with this? I think that trust is everything. Of course, I mean, if you have distrust, you will organize yourself in strong unions, and you will say no. Finland is fortunate to have a quite high level of trust. We still believe that our politicians are good and that they're thinking on us. And that, I think, is the main asset that we're having in the country. But I think that for this, we would need more European policies on code of conduct. I mean, you see what I've been working a lot in the third world, and they used to, the poor countries used to speak about the company should have a code of código de comportamiento for when behaving towards, and I think we have to have this, and I think it comes through a European cooperation, or at least I hope, because I don't like the alternative.
No, the people have paid very good in Holland, so that's not a problem. And we got the whole system of collaboration, because we had to fight against the water. So we have the polder model, where the unions always talk with the employers. Very good. We only have one more system from the government that's really very in favor of flex work. Yeah? So no, there are not many employment contracts. It's all flex. And so that's a problem sometimes. I think the salary is not the problem, but the funds for education, that's the next problem. How can we educate all those people for the new jobs we don't know yet? So that's going to be the real challenge.
With this challenge open, and that I think is a foresighting one, I think we can thank you, everybody, for that. And I give you the floor for closing the session.
Thank you. Yeah, we would like to express our gratitude for your presentations and for participating in this nice dialogue. Thank you. Eta zuei eskerrik asko, une etorri izanagatik, bihar jarraituko deu, gaur bezala, 9:00 PM. Eta biharkoan beste kasu batzuk izango ditugu, hain zuzen ere Roberto Di Meglio izango deu OIT-tik, hango tokiko lurralde garapenaren inguruko ikuspuntua emanez. Gero Bernard de Potter, Flandes Belgikatik, Francesco Paola Auzielo Emilia Romanatik, Italitik, eta azkenik Gipuzkoako Foru Aldundietik Aina Aizpuruk azalduko dugu hemen zein den bertako estrategia. Beraz, bihar arte, arratsaldeona pasa eta hemen ikusiko gara. Mila esker.